This is an interview with Clayton Holmes, a former NFL player. We are live, basically. It's myself, James Jobe, and Ted Metz of the Solutions Institute. And Clayton is here as well. So I want to just go into first, Clayton, with a little bit of your background. Tell us a little bit about growing up in the South, and give us a little bit of a nutshell of leading up to your life leading up to being drafted in the NFL in the 90s.
Okay. Growing up in the South, the one thing that I look back on and wish it wasn't this way is that you were told to do things and you were not able to share your opinion or your ideas. There was still racism in South Carolina when I was going to school there. My mother had four boys, and we all had different dads, and we moved around a lot. Real quick, I want people to understand that I'm going to be talking about some things. Some things may come up about my parents, but I am truly at peace with everything. The reason why I'm talking about these things is it's because it's my job to help now. People understand exactly why they're doing the things that they're doing. So I didn't grow up in a family that was very encouraging. There were a lot of curses put on us. And what I mean by curses is I don't think it's a cool idea to tell your son or daughter, you ain't going to be shit. You little demon, you little monster. So I feel like those words are like curses that you put on a child. And there was a lot of that when I grew up. And I know where it comes from. It's just this long chain of events that have happened in each of our families. And it's up for us to realize that and wake up and start changing things and making things better for the next generation.
Agreed. So do you feel like your family was a little bit emotionally abusive, or were they even physically abusive?
Physically, mentally, and sexually.
Wow.
Abusive.
Okay.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yep. And in some weird way, I'm thankful that I've figured this out now and why it happened. Like I said, if we would have been talking about this 15, 20 years ago, I would have been still in the blame game. But I definitely understand it. Half of the people in my family are ministers, from men to women, and they still have that anger in them. They don't have that peace in them yet. And that's what I'm here to do. I don't care what your religion is, who you believe what. I want you to be a better Christian or a better Mormon, whatever the case may be, if you choose to do that. And there's just not enough peace, and especially where I came from. They were never taught that. They were never taught peace and how to encourage people. It's difficult for someone to try to encourage someone if they've never experienced that before.
Understood.
So growing up in South Carolina, the first 11 years of my life, man, it's amazing. The first 11 years of my life, I was headed down the path of being a crook, a burglar, stealing. I remember the first time that I got, what I say, shown some love, I was with my older brother. We went to a store, and he told me that he was going to go distract the girl, talk to the lady at the counter, and he wanted me to, you know, get Snicker bars and Allerators and some other things. So we go into the store. I do what my brother says. And by the way, if Bam told you to do something, you did it. Or there were some serious consequences. So I went in the store, did what he did. We were leaving. And he looked over at me. He said, hey, man. He said, did you get it? I said, yeah. And then he put his arm around me. He said, oh, man, you did it, man. Good job. Good job. Now, I'm also hungry, too. So I'm walking down the street. I'm got chocolate around my mouth, and my brother just gave me some praise. So what do you think that I'm going to continue to do? I'm going to start stealing.
Right.
And that's exactly what happened. Went from stealing in stores to breaking in homes.
To gang mentality and clicking up with other people and that whole idea, right?
Yes, it was. Yep. Okay. It's not rocket science why I made the decisions that I've made. And because we are creatures of habit. We get programmed. We're going to get programmed by something. And I can see where I was getting led astray from the ages of 1 till about 11. So this is when my life started to change. We broke into a house. We get caught. I'm with my brother and three older guys. They lift me up and put me through the window. And my whole purpose for stealing when I was younger was to eat. I don't want to say hungry. A lot of people don't know what starving means. And it's hard for someone that's starving to obey any kind of laws. You're going to take care of that basic instinct, and that was to eat. So we break into this house, and I did the same thing at every house. The first thing I do is go to the kitchen. I used to love cereal. I go to the kitchen and I find me something to eat. So the older guys were in there looking for all the valuable stuff. We leave out of the house and my brother goes, "Hey man, let's go back in." And this was the first time I kind of stood up to Bam. I said, "Hey Bam, man, I'm gonna just stay out here and watch." I said, "You guys go back in." So they went back in. They were in there for a while. So I snuck back over there and I opened the door and they had that place ramshacked. Long story short, and we knew the guy. One of the guy's necklace fell off. So when the guy came from school, we got caught. Everybody goes to court. Those guys had their bags packed to go to juvenile detention. I got up to the judge. He said to me, and that was actually my first time really in front of a judge. He said to me, "Well, Mr. Holmes, since you didn't go back into the house that second time, we're going to show you some leniency." And they put me on probation. And then that's when my dad had just remarried, an up-and-coming nurse. And my dad also worked on the railroad. So my stepmother encouraged my dad to take my mom to court and get custody of me. It was the best thing that ever could have happened. I didn't think it at the time because they won the case. And that was actually the first time I tried to kill myself. That was the first time I saw my mom crying. I've never seen my mom cry. So I wrote a letter and put the letter up under my pillow and took some pills that she had on top of the refrigerator. But I woke up. And then when my dad came to get me. So I go from being poor.
Did you
poor,
go to the hospital at that event? Did you wind up in the hospital for after all taking all those pills?
No, I don't know what they were to this day. I just woke up. I didn't say anything to anybody. I just noticed that I woke up. I grabbed the letter and I tore it up and threw it in the trash. And so I go from being poor to waking up in the morning, fighting over shoes and socks and wearing clothes too big for me, to having my own room, cooking three meals a day. I got a whole new set of friends. I really started getting involved with sports. And sports saved my life. So I went from being poor to middle class, changed my whole group of friends. And we can talk more about what happened from that if you want to.
And you started playing sports and you started, was this in your high school age times?
No, I was 12. The first time, James, as I look back at my life now and with the understanding that I have, the first time I was enlightened, James, I was about 11 or 12, somewhere between 10 and 12. I started playing baseball. And I would always go up to the plate and I would just stand up there and I wouldn't swing the bat. I would just strike out. So, and this wasn't like it is now where everybody had to play. If you weren't playing good, then you just didn't get on the field. But we were killing this team and the coach decides to put me in the game. I go up there and I start doing the exact same thing. I'm standing up there just watching the balls go by. It's a full count. And the coach calls a timeout. He walks over to me and he says something so simple and so peaceful. He looked at me and he said, "Clayton," he said, "hey, son," he said, "swing the bat." And I said, "Okay, coach." So I go back in the batter's box and all I'm saying to myself is swing the bat, swing the bat, swing the bat. And he threw it and I swung and it was a foul tip. But James, the dugout went crazy. They was like, "Oh man, he touched it. And I turn and I look and I see these guys cheering for me. And again, I've never had anybody pat me on the back, cheer for me about anything. So dude, when I turned back around, it was like I was in the Matrix. It seemed like everything was moving in slow motion. I stand back in the batter's box and he threw the ball right down the middle of the plate and I stepped into it. Ting! It was one of the best feelings that went through my hands. and I'm running the first base, and I hear everybody yelling, "Drop the bat, drop the bat." So I drop the bat, I hit first base, second base, and I hit a triple. So I am standing on third base, and everybody's clapping, and I start laughing, and I could not stop laughing. And I was holding my head down, trying to stop laughing. And then all of a sudden, I lift my head up, and it was just completely dark. And then all of a sudden, I see this this light, like the sun. First, it was in my head. I see this light. And then I open my eyes, and I see this bright red dirt. I see the green grass. I hear birds chirping. I hear there's a swimming pool beside us. I hear people swimming in the swimming pool playing. And as I look back at my life, before I hit that ball, I was always in my head. I was worrying about if I was going to get my ass cut when I got home for doing something. Where was I going to eat? I used to rock and sway a lot. I was always in my head. But when I hit that baseball, it put me right in the moment. And that feeling right there is what I've been chasing in sports. It wasn't that I love football or track. It was just that feeling that it felt like I was a split second ahead of time, or I wasn't thinking anymore. I was just reacting. So that was my very first time being enlightened as I look back at it. And I was, again, somewhere around 10 and 12.
Gotcha. Okay. So then that the what a baseball was what started you off in sports, and then you moved on to football from there.
Yes, I actually tried out for the Expos and the Pirates. This was in 1988, and I don't think that there were any guys playing professional football and baseball. So I remember my dad sitting me down and asking me to make a decision, because the Expos came to work me out. And they wanted to invite me to their facility, but it was the same day of the Shrine Bowl. And I was the first one from our school to ever get selected to the Shrine Bowl. So my dad sat me down. He said, "Okay, make your mind up. Which sport do you want to go with?" And I went with football.
Okay. And then that went through high school all the way into college?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
I get, my grades were terrible in school. After my senior year of high school, the coach called me into his office, and he said, "Clayton, are you planning on going to college?" And I said, "College?" I said, "Coach, I don't even know if I'm going to graduate from high school." And again, I remember these profound moments when people are sincere and they say something to me. He put his hand on my leg and he said, "Son," he said, "you're going to graduate from high school. And," he said, "you're going to go to college." He said, "Hell, son, you can play professional football." That was the first time I've ever heard anything about professional football and me playing. And he was sincere, and I felt it. So when I leave his office, my next class was English class. I pull out my notepad, and I start practicing my autograph. Clayton Holmes, Dallas Cowboys. Clayton Holmes, Dallas Cowboys. Clayton Holmes, Dallas Cowboys on the entire page.
You were a kid? You were dreaming about playing for the Cowboys?
Yeah, I was on cloud nine that day. He really inspired me. And now, you know, I look back and I see these things about laws of attraction. And there was a couple things where I remember jotting things down and signing my autograph and writing the Dallas Cowboys was one of them. So that was in 1988. My coach found a junior college. They just started a football program. We went 10-1, North Greenville Junior College. I still wanted to go to Clemson, but my grades were not good enough. So my coach told me about Ken Sparks from Carson Newman. He said he would give me a full scholarship. I would be on work study because I had my first son right before my senior year in high school. So Coach Sparks asked me, he said, "So Clayton, are you planning on playing professional football?" And I said, "Yes, sir." I was playing quarterback and wide receiver at the time. And he said, "Well, I think that can happen if you move to defensive back." So I trusted him. 2 years at North Greenville, 2 years at Carson Newman. It's 1992. It's the year of the draft. so far, everything came true that Coach English told me. He said I was going to get into college. He said I was going to graduate from high school, and he said I was going to get into college. So it's 1992. It's the day of the draft. Long story short, around 5 or 6 o'clock Saturday, I think it was April the 12th, my dad and them are having a cookout. Everybody's getting a little tipsy, asking a lot of questions. So I go into my dad's room, and I say to him, hey, Pop, if the phone rang, don't answer it. I'll get it. So I go into his room. I sit down, and I just fall back on the bed, and the phone rang. And I jumped up, and I said, hello. And this guy goes, can I speak to Clayton Holmes? I said, this is Clayton Holmes. He said, hi, this is Jerry Jones. How would you like to be a Dallas Cowboy? And I said, I would love to be a Dallas Cowboy. And again, the rest is history.
So you played for them for a number of years, right?
Yes. I played for them. I got all of my credited seasons through the Cowboys, which is 4. I went to Miami for a spell in 97, but I was on the decline by that time. You know, I got suspended. I got suspended for cannabis. So, yeah.
Right. That leads us right into the next question here. So, talk about the incidents whatever incident was that led to you being tested, and that how'd you lose your contract with the NFL at that point?
Okay, it was after 3 years, my contract was up with the Cowboys. I wasn't smoking marijuana. The guys I hung out with, they smoked marijuana. And I remember I was about to ask my wife for a divorce. We were riding around in the car, and I said, they were smoking a joint. And I said, hey, man, I said, give me that joint. He was like, what? He's like, man, give me that joint, man. I'm about to ask my wife for a divorce. So I smoked a joint, and then all of a sudden, before that time, I was really shy. I didn't speak much. And so we just started talking about relationships, and I noticed the guys in the car, like, really quiet. They was like, damn, Clayton. They was like, say that again. I was like, say what? It was just like, damn, dude, you just on it. So I asked my wife for a divorce. 2 months later, Detroit Lions they were thinking about signing me. So I had to go up to Detroit to work out for them. And I remember I was up to 3 times smoking cannabis. So I remember calling my agent, and I said to him, I said, Tank, I said, I'm going up to Detroit, and they're going to, I see that they're going to test me. I said, I've been smoking marijuana. And he goes, oh, you're fine. He said, they can't test you for anything but steroids. There was a certain time back when I was playing that they could test you. And I'm like, okay, cool. So I go up to Detroit, and they give me the test. And then a week later, I get this call from Dr. Lawrence Brown, the NFL's drug doctor. And he said to me, and I was really naive about, you know, what would happen. He said to me, he said, can I speak to Clayton Holmes? I said, this is Clayton Holmes. He said, hi, this is Dr. Brown. He said, can you tell me why there's cannabis in your system? And I said, yeah, because I was smoking. And then he goes, okay, so that puts you into the NFL drug program, which means you got to submit 10 UAs a month. You got to go talk to the team psychiatrist. And I had to start going to AA and NA meetings. Now, keep in mind, I'm 2 months into this. So,
you were playing at the time, right?
Yes.
You were currently playing. Were you a first pick, second pick, or any kind? Did they drop down the time frame behind which you would be able to play? So they drop you down by picks whenever they learn that you were using cannabis?
Well, I was a second pick in the 3rd round when I got drafted. And then after that, it's not about picks anymore. It's just about once you get into the league, it's just about finding out who's the best in your position and trying to figure out where you think you fit in with that.
Right. Okay.
So I get the positive test. And when he said I had to talk to the team psychiatrist, I actually got excited. I was just like, shit, cool. I get to find out what makes me tick, because I was always living on the edge. I mean, doing silly things. And it just drove me crazy why I was doing some of the things that I was doing. Excuse me. So when he said that, I actually got a little excited. So I go into his office, I sit down, we introduce ourselves, and then the first thing he asked me, he said, "So, have you ever been mentally, physically, or sexually abused?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, tell me about it." And I was just like, it was like Pandora's box opened up. I was like, holy shit. This was the first time that I actually was thinking about the things that I went through. Now, something would come up before that, but I wouldn't sit there and dwell in it. Our mind has a way of, you know, blocking out traumatic events. But when he asked me that, it opened up Pandora's box. And I remember walking out of his office and I looked up in the sky and I said, "What the hell am I doing in Dallas?" And that is when, I guess you could say, my career really was on the decline. I didn't care. I was embarrassed about who I was. I hated everybody in my family. And that's when the journey started for me. And that was in 1995.
Okay. Then you filed a lawsuit at that time, correct?
Yes. And what the NFL did was they said that since I didn't appeal the tech, and they weren't supposed to give me the drug test, but the NFL thought Dallas gave me the drug test, which Dallas could have tested me for anything they wanted because I was under contract with them. So when we told when we told them that, hey, you know, that test didn't come from the Cowboys, it came from the Detroit Lions. And then they said, you didn't appeal in, 2 weeks? You didn't appeal in 2 weeks, so the drug test is still going to count.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Wow. So tell me about like the impact it had on your life and then your personal viewpoint regarding cannabis use now.
Yes. Again, I'm going to mention like destiny. I really, everything is truly making sense to me and what I've been through. What are the odds of me ending up in Washington State? I got here in 2009. I think in 2012, they became one of the first states to recreationally legalize cannabis. So before then, I was actually doing some studying. And then I actually got a job at a medical marijuana place called Have a Heart. And then I realized that the reason I was telling them when I was in treatment for using cannabis, I told them it helped with my focus. I could eat because we had to weigh in every week. And for every pound that you was over or under, it was $200. And I remember putting a weight in my jock sometimes because I've always been like that. When I work out intensely, I just don't eat. I can eat like one meal a day. So
I'm actually the same way.
Yeah. So
I'm the same way.
I was telling them, you know, the reasons why I'm using, help with my focus, sex was better, just my concentration. But again, it just went in one ear and out of the other.
So how much of a culture shock was that going from Carolina to Texas, to going from the South to winding up in later age in a state where it's recreationally available no matter where you go. It's almost on every corner, basically. And you can just work in the industry.
Yes.
It must have been a culture shock. I've never been to the South, so I don't know. I'm a California boy myself.
All right. And you know, one of the best things, the best feelings is that you don't have to hide it. You know, if you're in South Carolina, you got to hide what you're doing. And it is just so cool to realize that if I want to sit on my deck and if I want to smoke me a bowl, if I want to roll up me a blunt, I can sit out on my deck and I don't have to worry about, you know, anything. This is just absolutely amazing. And I got suspended for cannabis. I left a lot of money on the table. And I feel like this is part of my life to just honestly get people to understand that you are dealing with a herb that's an anti-inflammatory, that deals with pain, that can help with anxiety. There's creams, salves that you can use, that this plant can heal us naturally. And it's just good to not just be thinking it or thinking it's an idea, I have proof now. We have proof that this is medicine, and it's time for everyone to wake up.
Okay, so going back to the NFL, were you a part of the recent class action settlement that the players had brought regarding concussion injuries?
Yes, I actually just got back from California yesterday because I did do the test back in October, and it was found that I do have some issues. So I just got back from California, letting the NFL doctors check me out now. And James, this has all been a part of my plan as far as it comes to bettering myself. I've had problems in school with my memory, and things have just been getting worse. And now that we've pinpointed what we think the problems are, and there's treatment programs, again, for the last 15, 20 years, I have been dealing with my anger, my shyness, and I have overcome a lot of things. Now, with that being said, I'm not saying that I don't have any more work. I'm just in the maintain mode, you know, keep doing the same things that I've been doing to help me get to this point of understanding.
Right. Okay. So what is that? What's your personal opinion then regarding the debate with the concussions in the NFL and with children, and have you gone on board with that, or what?
Yes.
Speak to us a little bit about that.
I the treatment that I'm going to do, and I'm taking this very serious. They talk about things like ADD and dyslexia, and I have a question for the doctors out there. I wonder if those things can be caused from concussions also. Now, I remember getting concussions when I was little, concussions in high school. I remember concussions in the NFL. And they weren't all football that I've been knocked out. So there's a reason why I had a problem with learning. And it wasn't because I was dumb or stupid. There's a legitimate reason. So they're new to this. There's this thing called CTE, and they can't tell if that's what you have until you're dead, and they do the brain scan, or they do the autopsy. So they're working to try and find out better ways to find out if you have CTE. And I am on board with this whole process, because I believe that concussions have something to do with what they call ADD and dyslexia. These things come from someplace, right, along with food, other things like that.
I understand what you mean. I'm an avid skateboarder, and I don't like wearing safety equipment because I believe it hinders my ability to actually skate. Mm-hmm. And I've concussed myself a few mm-hmm. times. Mm-hmm. So I know what you mean, and it's not pleasant, and it doesn't, you know, it's definitely something you need to be very, very, like, it needs to be watched out for. And there's this big issue with it. There's probably something that's going to come to a head soon, and I'm going to continue watching. I'm sure you will as well.
Yes.
Okay. So now do you currently have a medical recommendation from a doctor for cannabis
yes.
use?
Okay. Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Talk a little bit about that, about recreational, the difference between recreational and medical, and help, you know, I know it, but let's talk with other people about it. Let's get your opinion on
okay.
it.
Okay. The difference between recreational and medical, when you go into a recreational shop here in Wenatchee now, or in Washington, they can't talk to you on a medical basis. Let's say if you come in and you say, hey, I got stage 3 cancer, I got a tumor, what medicine would you suggest? And they can't talk about that. Now, when they did have medical here, and it's really embarrassing what they've done to medical in the state of Washington. When they did have medical here, you could come in and whatever ailments that you have, we could prescribe something on a medical basis that we would think that would help you with the situation. And the company that I worked at, they were amazing. It was called Have a Heart. and we were constantly being educated on the plant, the cannabinoids, and the endocrine system. We were constantly educated on that. So they to talk to someone now about medical issues, you can't do that. So they're doing what I didn't hope that they would do, and that is they're just making this all about recreational. And we need to continue to talk about the medical benefits of this plant.
That, right.
And it's just that simple. But this is about money for those guys, and they're already starting with this.
I know it better than you do. Yeah. So the recreational, the only reason that it is so recreationally used is because there is a lot of medicinal benefits that are being self-prescribed by people on their own. So, and that's most of every drug user, even with cocaine and heroin and things like that. People are using these drugs as some sort of medicinal value, as some sort of physical or mental medicinal help for themselves. Mm-hmm. And that's basically what it is. And, you know, marijuana use is basically the same thing, but on such a scale that such a safer scale than almost any like pharmaceutical substance or any other illicit substance you can get, mm-hmm. that the world is waking up to it and suggesting that this plant just be able to be used outright, which I agree with. I'm not mm-hmm. going to disagree with that whatsoever, because I will on camera take dabs. So
yeah.
I'm not worried at all about it. So but I'm also in a place where it's okay, and it's not that big of a deal. But I really like the fact that you you want to focus your attention and focus the questions for this debate to go further on the medicinal value of the plant, because that is therein lies where we get our recreational use anyway.
Exactly, buddy. That is just so simple to me. I'm an understanding person, and if you could show me something that proves that cannabis is bad for you, or that it's going to kill you, and the problem that a lot of people run into, cannabis is just like beer or wine in the aspect of there's certain beers, there's certain wines, certain liquors that you don't drink because they mess your stomach up, they give you hangovers the next day, and you can't mm-hmm. judge the entire cannabis plant because you had a bad experience. What you need to do is familiarize yourself with indica, sativas, the hybrid, find out more about yourself. If you are a person that's, you know, already up and jittery, then you may not want to mess with too many sativas. So again, it's just finding the right components in that plant for you. And when I found out that those compounds in that plant, our body already produces those compounds. It's like,
right.
Yeah. So we're not putting anything foreign. It's like native to my body.
The only thing the plant does, and the only thing basically any drug does, is increase the amount of dopamine that your mind receives on a individual connector basis. So each mm-hmm. individual connector receives a little bit more dopamine than it would have before if you use a specific substance, and cannabis is the same way. It increases the dopamine that you get, and in some cases it increases the serotonin as well. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of things that happen, and it's always on a user basis. You're right. You're absolutely right. If people mm-hmm. familiarize themselves with cannabis and with all of the specific cannabis outlets, so there's edibles. You don't want to smoke. There's edibles. Mm. You can have an edible that's way strong, and you can have an edible that's really, really minimally THC or even just cannabinoids. It just has CBD in it. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of ways to utilize cannabis that are outside the norm of smoking a joint.
Yes. And that was actually the first time that I really like fell in love with cannabis, and I had this feeling that, man, I can stand in front of anybody and profess my love. There was this lady that came in to have a heart. She was in her late 60s, and she said that she's having a lot of pain in her hands, and she didn't want to get high. And she asked me, what kind of topicals do we have? So I gave her three of them, and one of them was a remedy stick. It's great it's great for migraines. You just rub it on your head and you rub it in, and it actually works on migraines. So she took that. 2 weeks later, 2-3 weeks later, she came back to the shop. I opened the door for her, and she went to the counter and she grabbed all of them. She grabbed every last remedy stick, and she said, Clayton, I've been in pain for a long time and I've never found anything that worked like this. And then that's when I was just like, man, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. And it's people like you that are going to help us understand what this plan is about, respect it, and use it to heal ourselves, because that's what it's for. And the hemp, we can put hemp, we can plant hemp, and that can help, save the earth.
Get the toxins. You're absolutely right. The deforestation can be completely wiped out by just utilizing cannabis and hemp as fields.
Yes, it used
to be that way. There was a time in America when there were laws drafted where if farmers did not grow hemp, they were taxed.
Wow.
Yes.
That's amazing.
Uh-huh.
That's absolutely amazing.
On this plant. Okay, so let me circle back a little bit to the NFL with cannabis involved. Let's see. I've seen a statistic, and I want to get your opinion on it, that about 50% of the players in the NFL use cannabis and just do it on the down low.
Oh yes. What you
believe that?
Yes. I think it may be more than 50%. There are some guys that are really smart, and then there are some guys that are young and kind of go overboard. But let's put it like this. They do a random steroid test. I know they were doing it when I was playing, where you come in and every day the computer spits five names out of the computer or out of the roster, and you have to do a steroid test. If they did that for cannabis, there probably wouldn't be an NFL. If they spit those five names out and said, all right, you got to take, there would not be an NFL probably.
That's great. What advice do you have for any players that are currently in the NFL? Any players that use and want to hide it, or that don't have a medical recommendation, or this type of ordeal?
I would say continue to educate yourself on this plant, and you join the movement with helping get this off of the banned substance list. And a lot of people hear me talk about this and they think that I'm giving guys like the green flag, just, hey, smoke anytime you want. It's just like, no, man, you can't come to work drunk. You can't play drunk. You can't come to work high. You can't play high. This is when you're at home after a game practice and you're sitting in the comforts of your home. And if you want to use some cannabis to help you feel better. And this is the other thing. I signed a contract for $1.3 million. And it was basically, I would say about 50% of the guys, we would still go to a guy's house. We didn't know if it was indica, sativa. We didn't know what we were smoking. We was just hoping that it was going to be something good. So my suggestion would be to just educate yourself. Continue to educate yourself and join the movement, because you're not doing anything wrong as far as nature is concerned with this plant.
And that can cross over too to anyone that is lives in a state that has the stigma that cannabis use has there, where it hasn't gotten. California, Nevada now, Washington, Oregon, Colorado, these places, we're really speaking to a wall. But the southern states, there's about 9-10 states that still have a pretty harsh prohibition on on cannabis use. Mm-hmm. And it's going to turn around. It's just going to turn around. It just is a matter of time. It's not if, but when.
Yes. If alcohol made its way back, cannabis will.
Indeed. Okay. So what ventures, we'll round it off here a little bit and finish it off with a little bit of discussion, probably outside of my questionnaires that I had beforehand, but what ventures do you have planned for the future? What are you going to go on with?
Oh, my plans for the future is now to share my life story, to do the things that I'm doing now. Ted has been absolutely amazing with helping me get things organized, meeting people. I have a weakness, and I understand, especially playing football, the power of the team to help you get things organized. So my goal now is, again, brother, I am truly at peace. I have no more questions. I understand my life. I understand what I feel like God is. And now my goal is just to share my life and how I overcame certain things, how I was able to take responsibility for myself, work on myself. So that's just my goal now, is just to share this beautiful life that I've lived and to help people feel good about themselves and give them some, you know, some hope that they are here for a reason and they got things to do. And if you've been through some shit in your life, you are definitely one of the special ones, because your goal is to learn from it. Just look at it with an understanding heart and learn from it. There's a lesson in it. And then when you learn, you're going to be able to help millions of people in that same situation.
Excellent. Well said. Ted, do you have any questions you want to ask or any input you want to throw in here?
I can't think of anything in particular that I want to ask Clayton. I will
say you've heard a lot of this anyway, so.
Quite a bit of it. What I would like to ask Clayton to do, if he doesn't mind, is to give Peachtree Normal a shout out for a happy 2017 and a positive impact on our legislative session coming up.
Peachtree Normal, yes, big shout out to them. I hear you guys are really trying to, you got a nice movement going on down there. So big shout out for Peachtree and what you guys are normal and what you guys are doing. And I definitely see the results of that being something really, really positive.
Normal in and of itself is amazing. If you've never visited the website and you just have 2 hours to go through and look at some great articles regarding cannabis, yes. Normal is amazing.
Yes. Yep. I think the decriminalization of the plant, I think that is also awesome too. And one other thing that's going to be awesome is when we get that plant off of the Schedule One narcotic, that needs to be off of that. That the more I think about it, that is just so ridiculous. Nobody has ever died from that plant. More people die from drinking coffee than somebody dying from cannabis.
Yeah, just to make the claim that that's what Schedule One means, is that there's absolutely no medical benefit from the substance whatsoever, and that its only use is illicit, and it's really not right. That's not right for cannabis. It's not right for psychedelics, if you ask me. There's a lot of different things that could get removed from Schedule One, if you ask me. But I'm a little bit more progressive in that area.
There you go. I have a whole new outlook on drugs. I've learned about psychedelics and anything that's natural, man. If your mind is in the right place and if you're looking for answers, I do feel like there's a spiritual side of things, and these plants and herbs out here can help us get in touch with what's going on and finding answers to build and make things. It's just all this information is out there and we need assistance. And if you're with the right people and you're understanding that, man, natural drugs are absolutely amazing. Absolutely.
Obviously they were put on our planet for a reason.
Exactly, bro. Exactly. But unfortunately,
Big Pharma seems to be our greatest nemesis in being able to self-medicate with natural plants that grow out of the ground that you can grow yourself and not have to pay anyone for it. It's aggravating, to say the very least.
Mm-hmm. It's just amazing how they've still have the entire portion of the world still like brainwashed, that have no idea that what we've been told was just an absolute lie. We were told that cannabis kills brain cells. If anything, it helps brain cells. It's just so much that we've been lied to about. And once you get programmed, man, if you're not an open person, it's going to be really difficult for you to just think different. And that's the hold that they have on us. But we finna nip that shit in the bud, and people are waking up. This is a time of information now. And it's just beautiful to connect with the people that I've connected with to help get this truth out. Found something to die for, and that's a beautiful thing, man.
Awesome. So we're gonna move on forward, right, with trying to keep legislation going into Supreme Court to get removed from the Schedule One list from the on the FDA's end. But we're gonna get some opposition from that. We already have started to get opposition from the DEA, mm-hmm. With their recent listing of CBD and extraction from cannabis plants as Schedule One and in and of themselves. So they are no longer just cannabis section. They are a item to be listed on own and as Schedule One, so that if cannabis is removed, extractions like CBD oil and dab oils and things like that will still be considered Schedule One.
Wow. And my thing is, I would be like, okay, so can you show me the information that made you make that decision? What is it? I mean, seriously, just what is it that makes this a Schedule One drug? And that,
right.
Yeah.
Obviously the answer to that is Big Pharma.
Right.
Exactly.
And not just that, but also law enforcement. There's a big, big stigma on extraction process, for especially volatile extraction process. So, and I've done this before. I've actually made dabs before. So, you know, with butane, with a volatile extraction. If you ever put a spark around me at that point, yeah, I would have blown myself up. And
yeah.
So, but you, to know the limitations you need to have, and to know the surroundings you need to put yourself in to do so properly is one thing, but there is a lot of stigma from law enforcement regarding, and I mean, quite on my own too. I would never tell somebody to do a volatile extraction of cannabis in an apartment, mm-hmm. inside a home, or RV or anything of that nature, because mm-hmm. it's just not smart. But that's one of the reasonings behind it. I know that because California and just Fresno County alone in the last 5 years, the news is riddled with it. People that just blow themselves up in their apartments or whatever.
Wow.
Trying to make dabs.
Yeah. We've had that in Seattle a couple times that has happened also. So I can definitely see,
there's a side to it that makes sense.
Back in the 90s, and look at all the Richard Pryor lighting himself on fire, doing cocaine freebasing.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it's not like we don't have a history of using volatile chemicals.
Yeah, it's like James said too, is people just really have to be educated. And I guarantee you, it's those ones that don't understand the air and the proper way to make the oils and the dabs. So again, I definitely don't think it needs to be a Schedule One for that reason, because again, we are talking about medicine that can kill cancer cells. We're talking about a medicine that can help a child who's banging his or her head against a wall, who's having epileptic seizures. We're talking about that plant right there. And we just need to get the laws right and just let people use this medicine for health purposes. That should be the main focus, because it has been proven that's what it's for.
Agreed.
Yeah.
I want to smoke.
Hey, me too. I think I got me a little bowl in there. I'm gonna go grab it.
Yeah, I got one right here too. But
here it is.
I'll wait till we stop the recording.
I'll edit it till we stop.
Yep, and I'll be right back.
Uh-oh, I think he's going to get his bowl. Well, if he's going to smoke his, I'm gonna...
That's it.
It's my own too. It's.
I love Washington, man. I truly love it. I have found myself here in the state of Washington.
I'm gonna end the recording now. So let me see.